get on your feet, get into gear and hit the street.
Hey you,
get moving, it's not too far. You're looking good, so come as you are.
Hey you,
you never know what you see when you through that door with the 7-3. Never seen nothing, no, not like this place. Never been, no, no way, not ever, no. Never seen no place, no way similar, not like 73. Hey you, get ready, get on your feet, get into gear and hit the street. It's you that we wanna see, so get down to 73. Get down to 73. Hey you, get down to 73.
No. I'm not all here. There's only half of me here. Oh, Fred, we can't halve everything, Fred. We can't. Fred, don't chop it up. No, Fred. Fred! Oh. Hello. Oh, how embarrassing. I wanted to be up long before you got here. Oh, no. La, 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 la. Oh, I've had complaints about my voice this week, you know, complaints. All I've got to say about that is, did you see the winners of the Eurovision Song Contest last week? The story, or should I say the saga, of me and Fred is still continuing, you know? But now, it's just been blown out of all proportion. He was up in that blimmin' room, 5 o'clock in the morning, mending his bike. Do you know what? What no one seems to realise around here is that all I want is just a little bit of independence. Yeah, some independence. Like the independence of a lone explorer, or the wealth of Tutankhamun with the status of a king, the popularity of Margaret Thatcher. Well, Culture Club at least, anyway. And where am I? I'm in bed, in number 73, in a hall.
Morning. Oh, Harry. Look, I want you to know I'm really sorry about all this business between you and Fred. I have to share everything.
Oh, I don't know what to say, Dawn. You're a pal.
Yes, I am. I want you to always remember that, OK? Oh. But there's one thing.
What's that?
I need to take this half of the bed back because Fred needs it right now.
What? Oh, this... This is this is just great. Half a bed.
Okay, half a bed, half a bike.
Oh, ha ha ha! Very funny, very funny. Another thing about Freddy's taking this halving business too literally, you know.
Oh,
look.
Oh. Be careful, gang. I think that back wheel might not be on properly.
I think I'm probably right. Oh, Harry, half dressed.
Morning. I've only got one word to say to you this morning. Asunder. Fred and Harold have split the normal peaceful atmosphere of my home. Asunder. Me? I'm going to finish my breakfast.
I just don't know what that woman's going on about half the time, I tell you. I really.
Good morning, Harry. Good morning. What are you doing?
I'm just there in the bed. You know how it is. What are you doing, Kim?
I'm looking for Leee from imagination. You haven't seen him, have you?
Well, actually, that's why I've been sitting down here waiting for him to pop through that. Of course, I haven't seen him. Is he coming here?
Yeah.
Oh, great. Why?
Well, you know how much I love tomato sauce. He's coming to get his shirt. You see, I met Leee at the cinema last night. Well, when I say met, we had a few words. Mostly about the way my hot dog sort of jumped out onto his shirt. Oh, it was about that long it was, and it had mustard on it as well. But Barbara Streisand was wonderful. Harry, you should see Yentl.
Yentl, she's mental. You know what I'm saying?
Tracker,
what's with all the...
I'm looking for Tracker,
What's a Tracker?
He's my dog.
Okay. Everybody in this house is nuts.
Nuts?
When am I going to get some privacy?
You ought to try in your bedroom, Harry.
Oh, thank you, Tom. Say hello, Tom.
Hello, Tom. Have you seen Dawn anywhere?
I'd try upstairs, Tom. I would.
Oh, all right. Thank
You're
you,
welcome.
Harry.
I'm going to get out of this bed if it kills me, which it most probably will do. So, if you wouldn't mind, op it.
Ah, lovely cup of coffee. There's something so civilised about starting the morning with a proper breakfast. Coffee and bicycle chain. Look, gang, what happened to my kippers?
Oh, you know, Ethel, bare breath on a bone. Gang to Tracker.
Oh, that's nice. Feed my breakfast to the dog. I'm very pleased.
Don't talk to us now, Ethel. We've got a bit on.
Look, you're not even supposed to be doing this in the front room.
We've got paper down.
Yeah, I know, but it's this morning's paper. Good Lord, look at that. Well, look, just go anywhere except in here, all right, please?
In your bedroom.
Not my bedroom.
bedroom. Go in Harry's room. Fred's room. Fred and Harry's room. Marry and Fred's room. They're going to drive me mad, those two. I cannot believe the trouble we've had. The only person who seems to be able to deal with them is Tony Deal. And he's not here this morning. What? Oh, me and Tony, you know, we're just good friends. What? Say nothing. I know, I think I'll have a piece of toast.
Toast, I got the toast.
Oh, I said toast, not
we'll have
post.
A piece of that as well.
Well, you have that and I'll have some post. Wait a minute, I've ended up without toast. Oh, there we go.
Hey, why didn't Fred bring the post this morning?
Oh, well, he didn't go on his delivery. You know, he was up all night mending his bicycle and I just popped in. He's fallen asleep over his brake cables.
So that's why he asked me to get his half of the bed.
And that's why Harry's in the hall.
Actually, there's a nice letter here to Harry. And it's from Sandi from Oxfordshire. She says, "Dear Harry, I am just writing to say that I feel sorry for you. I mean, Fred the postman treated you bad, and so does Ethel. Look at last week when you and Fred shared an apple and you only had a little piece. And you only had a little bite. And when you showed Ethel, all she did was say thank you and eat it. I think that's terrible. What you need to have at number 73 is someone who is kind and will look after you properly. I'm not saying you're a baby. I mean, you must be in your 20s, but look around for someone.
I wish you would find somebody. Somebody else take his socks to the laundrette. It's a terrible trip, that. I hate having to do that. I've got a nice letter here from Paul Clarkson. And Paul's got some very important questions to ask me. He asks, why does my mum make me wear a jumper when she feels cold? Secondly, he asks, if my sister puts nail varnish on her nails, it chips off within 2 days. But if she spills it on her dress, it's on for life. Why? We see, those are the kind of questions that are never answered in agony columns, and they're very good questions, Paul. I shall be answering you under separate cover. If anybody's got any problems at all of that nature, which they want me to deal with, I'll be most happy.
Ethel, little rhyme here for you.
It's not rude.
From Jonathan Webb in Somerset. No, it's not rude. Listen to this. She stood on the bridge at midnight, her lips were all a quiver. She gave a cough, her leg fell off and floated down the river.
Oh, I like that. Limerick. So we've got here a letter from Amanda Foster. Excuse me, Amanda, speaking with my mouthful. Dear Ethel, I saw number 73 last week and I think you should become an astronaut for your career.
Astronaut?
You could fly the space shuttle and drop Dawn, Fred, Harry in space and come home and have a peaceful house.
Well, that's nice.
That's a terrific idea. That's one of the best ideas. Actually, come to think of it, I've got a friend of mine who's called Fred Talbot and he's into space and all things like that. And perhaps I'll get him to come and visit me and advise whether I could become an astronaut.
Come in! I can't see you as an astronaut.
Oh, why not?
Hello!
Hello!
How are you doing? When are we going to get on with this music?
Oh, right now,
Tom's kind of drum, isn't it? I've got something I want you to do for me. You know about the 73 novel?
Oh, yes.
Can I explain it?
Tell.
OK. For the past 2 weeks, we've been collecting chapters of the 73 novel. It all started when Roger McGough wrote me the first chapter containing exactly 73 words. And it finished with ... And we all wonder what was going to happen next in this novel by Roger McGough. When Karen Churchard wrote me the second chapter containing exactly 73 words. And I asked everybody to listen very carefully, and now we've had the third chapter, which is written by Annabel Lloyd, and I want you to read it, and I want everybody to listen very carefully, because it could be that you may want to write chapter 4 containing 73 words. Hit it, Tom.
Suddenly, the room went dark for about 30 seconds. Then the lights came on. They looked suspiciously at the table. It's gone! Just disappeared! ... Cool. Chapter 3 by Annabel Lloyd. Play the video cassette, said Roger. So Ethel did. On the screen appeared a hooded, faceless man. I am the power of the universe, he said. The bottle is not a cocktail mix, but the world support system. Lose it to evil, and the world is doomed. You must guard it with your life. You are the world's protector. The Earth is doomed, said Roger, unless, said Ethel mysteriously, it can be recovered. Oh. ...
Next.
Well,
if you've got any ideas, please do write and tell us quickly and put us out of our misery. We wonder what's going to happen. Send us chapter 4 containing exactly 73 words and send it to... Here we go, clear your throats.
Number 73, P.O. Box 73, Maidstone, Kent. Me 15, 6 R's.
Yeah, I think we'd better get a professional to do it.
I think so.
Number 73, P.O. Box 73, Maidstone, Kent, ME156RS.
Good lad, that. Good lad.
Yeah, listen, look what I found. Dearest Ethel, thank you for being such a friend on Saturday. I'm a lot more confident now. I think if you're not doing anything next Saturday, neither am I. Would you like to come out for a meal and perhaps a disco? Ooh. I know a good place. Sorry, this postcard's a bit small. Lots of love. Tony Deal!
Oh, no, that's private.
Not surprised. What about Fred?
Well, I was going out with Fred, but well, he's living in the same house now, and people would talk, you see.
And what about Tony Deal?
Yes. Well, I haven't quite decided yet about that, but I have decided one thing.
What's
that? Yeah, I'm going to get a job.
A job?
Oh, come on, it's not that strange. You both got jobs.
Oh, we're young. Or at least I'm young and he's talented.
Oh, that's nice. I'm going.
Oh, come on.
No, no,
what is it?
I've got egg stains.
Oh, come on, bunny girl minor. Oh, come on. Oh, Ethel getting a job. Whatever next?
Well, I don't know.
What about this music now?
Well, before we start on that, you'll have to just read this little book about mastering computers. It's ever so easy.
Read this whole book?
Yes, just flip through it and then we can actually start on the computer music course.
Oh! Look,
calm down, Harold. What is it? A charade. Okay, what does it sound like? Stab, mad, no, dead. Sounds like dead. Fred. Oh, okay, how many syllables in the rest of it? Yeah, okay, lots of syllables. Fred what? Fred blue pea shooter. Fred horn torn. Fred's torn all your clothing. I got it on the nose. Okay, I'll do one. It's a film and it's
Ethel.
What? Oh, see, Fred really has torn all your clothing. Oh, I'm sorry, Harry. I don't know why he does these things. Well, it's a nice warm day today. You could look on it as a fashion point. You'll only ever need half the fabric conditioner. Isn't that terrible? I don't know why Fred does these things. And you could see why Harry'd be so cut up about it.
Cut up about it? Don't tell him I made a joke.
For a while.
Oh,
just let me fix this.
No,
gang, don't do that in here.
Why not?
Well, because you're making me dizzy. Oh, dear. Right, decide who's going to do the washing up.
You. Right, then I'll dip. Eachy, peachy, pear, plum, you are the one.
Okay.
I don't understand it, but there you are. Right, you're doing the cartoon. Come on now.
Ethel?
Yeah?
What are you going to do about Fred and Harry?
Oh, well, I haven't quite decided yet, really.
What are you going to do about Fred and Tony?
Fred and Tony? Well, I haven't quite decided yet, really.
Well, are you going to stay for cartoon, then?
Oh, well, get the blind, would you? Yeah, I haven't quite decided yet. What cartoon is it?
I haven't quite decided yet.
Oh, very good, very fine. Excuse me, Russell. You're lucky you've got any eyes left. Here we go, now, come on. And five, four, three, two, one, a blast!
That is outrageous.
Oh, it's not that bad. I thought I cleaned my tyres this morning.
There is no excuse. It is simply outrageous. I mean, kids, look at... Kids, hello. Well, it is. It's outrageous. I have never seen anything... I mean, it's outrageous.
You finally come to your senses, eh? Fred is outrageous. Well, couldn't agree with you more.
No, I'm not talking about that. Look at this Herald.
Yeah.
No, the Maidstone Herald, Harold. Harold, look at the paper, Harold. There's a letter in here printed from him next door.
Oh, Martin.
Of number 75. Listen to this.
Yeah.
Sir, I live in what was once a desirable neighbourhood. I say once because now there is a blight on it. A blight in the form of one Miss Ethel Davis. That's me. Shh, listen. Who lives next door to me in company with an assortment of degenerates, dropouts and desperados in number 73.
Oh, one minute.
I am a respectable, reasonable man, but when one is subjected to constant, outrageous levels of noise, a stream of unwashed weirdos, wild beasts of every description, enough is enough. To my certain knowledge, all my fellow residents are in agreement with me. Therefore, I would be pleased to hear from any readers who have suffered from similar problems and would care to join my newly formed Society for the Prevention of Disorderly Conduct. Yours respectfully, Martin Edwards.
Well, forgive me for saying so, Ethel, but it is your fault, you know.
Oh, that's nice, Harry. I thought at least you would support me. How's it my fault?
Well,
what about the noise this morning, the shouting and screaming? That was you, nothing to do with
Ethel,
me.
Ethel, the noise.
That noise would never have happened if you hadn't let Fred here, right?
Let Fred here? You make it sound like it's my fault. It happened. It wasn't anything I could do anything about.
You say it's my fault, I say it's your fault, right? You just let the bands come in here having their own sweet way.
I let the bands come in here last week. I didn't even know there was a band. I went down into the cellar, suddenly there's Mari Wilson. Ain't that do ya? I didn't even know she was going to shop. I never know it's going to turn up. Any minute could be,
Jack, 150.
Jack, with 150 people for lunch. Jack's bringing 150 people for lunch. Harry, I'm never going to have enough bread.
I'm not people, Ethel. Underpants.
Oh, you're selling underpants now. Yes. Well, listen, I meant to say, don't use my phone for business calls because the bills are astronomical.
Okay. Well, I'll pay you for the phones when you pay me for the petrol, okay? But not for the petrol, the projector.
Don't bring that up again. You talked about the petrol to get the projector, talk about the projector. I don't want to talk about it anymore.
Ethel, what you don't seem to realise is that I've got some very good connections.
Oh, yeah?
And I just might be able to help you in the future.
Help me with what?
Pick a subject, any subject you like.
All right. You find me somebody to help me choose a career.
OK. You don't think I can... You don't think I can do...
No.
I'll prove it to you.
This I got to see. I don't know why everybody blames me. I don't know half of what's going on in this house. See? There's a noise in the lounge. I don't know what it is. Go and have a look for me, would you please?
So that's a synthesizer, just like Howard Jones, but with his backing tapes.
That's right. In fact, it's a digital programmable algorithm synthesizer. Except that Howard Jones doesn't use backing tapes.
Does he not? He uses just this.
No, he uses something like this.
What's one of these?
Well, that's a Roland microprocessor-based digital polyphonic MIDI sequencer, actually.
Oh, really?
Yes.
What does it do?
Well...
Oh, it's like a tape recorder.
It's sort of like a tape recorder. It records what I just played then. But unlike a tape recorder, you can play it faster or slower. Back.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
And with different sounds on it. And it can run, I think, about 16 different keyboards, all playing different parts, all at the same time, off that.
So you can really play around. It's like a big toy, isn't it?
Oh, yes, it's
a wonderful toy. Tom, you can play the piano, and I can't play the piano, so I couldn't use this, could I, really?
Of course you could. You don't have to be able to play the piano to play these things. Goodness, look, what you do, wipe that off, put it in step time, and then each time you press a note here, that will be one note. Each time you press that button there, it won't play, so... Have a go. Play one there, once on that button, twice on there, once on that button, once there. And what we've got... Again. One. Twice.
There.
Just once. Twice there. Once there. And once there. Whatever you want. Whatever you need.
It's really good. Has this got a drum machine on it? I mean, how do you get your drums in?
Well, the drums is different. The drums is worked by the drummer, and it's so easy that it could be programmed in your sleep. In fact, there's...
Is that your drummer?
Yes, that's Steve,
my
drummer.
Well, he's working hard, isn't he?
Oh, he's programming in his sleep. Steve!
Steve! Come on, wake up.
Dawn wants to see your drum machine.
Is that a synthesizer as well, Steve?
Oh, no, this is real drum kit sounds recorded into the machine. And I can play them all, like the bass drum and the snare drum. And the cymbals are all real sounds.
So there's a huge drum machine in there.
Use them by playing on the buttons.
Can you make it play on its own?
Yes.
No hands.
It's the cymbal I like, and cabasses.
Oh, I want to get going on this. What's that thing there? Can I play that?
Oh, that's Roland, but unfortunately, we haven't got a plug for it.
No plug. We've got all this stuff and...
Oh, Harry.
Plug, yeah.
Yes, well, Dawn, you're wanted urgently in the kitchen, so get out, right?
Right. Now, excuse me, Tom.
I heard you wanted a plug, mate.
Well, yes, as a matter of fact, I was trying to get a plug for Roland.
Oh, plug for... Look, Tom... Tom! I do such a good line in plugs, mate. It isn't true.
I bet it isn't.
None of this... come on, believe me. None of this falling off the back of lorry stuff. Oh, no.
For a change.
For a change. Now, listen, Tom. You do a lot of concerts, right?
True.
In a lot of big old halls.
Sometimes.
Now then, these big old halls, they all use round pin plugs.
Harry, when was the last time you went to a concert?
It was an ABBA concert, Tom. It was an ABBA concert and listen to me, they use round pin plugs.
Harry, all my plugs are square.
Okay.
This is round, it will not fit.
Look, let me put it this way, okay? Your gear uses up a lot of electricity, right?
Yes.
A lot of electricity. Now then, these silly, rotten little old square pin plugs, they only give out 13 amps, right?
Well, it is true. I like to have at least 15 amps on a stage.
Right. Now, what does that say there, Tom? 15 amps, thank you very much.
Harry, how much are you asking for this priceless gem?
I think about 65 pence. It's a bargain, Tom. It gives out more juice, more electricity for half the money.
Make it 50 pence and you've got yourself a deal.
You're on. OK.
I'll pay you next week.
OK, I'll give you the plugs next week as well. Thank you.
That's great.
Outrageous.
That's what I said.
It's outrageous. You should do something...
He put here, my newly formed society for the prevention of disorderly conduct.
You should do something about it, Ethel.
Well, like what?
Well, why don't you write to the paper?
No, it's a rubbish newspaper. I was thinking of reporting it to my local councillor.
Well, who's he?
You should know he works for you.
Does he?
Yes.
I ought to meet him here, oughtn't I?
Yes.
It's outrageous.
It is, isn't it? I just can't... I mean, the whole thing is outrageous.
You've told her, then. You've told her. It's terrible, isn't it? Outrageous.
Listen, is it time?
I think it must be time.
I think it's time.
Get the others, would you?
Will do.
Ricochet.
You remember last week when Harry ruined all my makeup making out Fred as an old hag? Well, he had to do that because Fred had many parts to play in our new feature film.
And we spent 4 days last week making this film. It's a spaghetti western. Now, the thing is, it's very low budget, so we couldn't afford any actors, so we played all the parts.
There's Fred, Harry, you and me.
Yep. See if you can guess who's playing which part. Are you ready, guys?
I'll get blind.
Yeah. Here we go. Come on. No, of course you haven't. Sit down. Okay,
okay guys,
sit down here.
Here we go. You ready? And
Ricochet! Hey-ya!
Woo! Great stuff, Mum!
The Wild West. America's frontier. The New World. Conjuring up such magical names as Billy the Kid, Wild Bill Ballcock, and Big Chief Running Nose, none of whom appear in this story, because this is the story of... Ricochet.
Someone better tell the mayor.
Gold. Gold. Buried under the saloon. Oh, how could I have missed it all these years? Right here in East Clintwood.
Come again.
I said, stick your hands up and give me the money.
If I'll stick my hands up, how can I give you the money?
All right, just let me think about that for a second. You stick your... Turn the lights out!
What in tarnation do you think you were doing in there?
I'm robbing the bank.
But you're the sheriff.
I am.
Sheriff Beans of East Clintwood.
Oh, golly, that's right. That security check. We got little enough money in this town as it is. I don't want nobody stealing it.
Not for long. I, Mayor Jebediah T. Slug, have discovered gold buried under the saloon.
Gold? Then we'll all be rich. Gold!
Sheriff Beans, please.
Gold?
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 No gold in this here town.
A cold. He has a cold.
Oh, a cold.
Yes. don't be so hard-faced, Beans. Do you realize what this means? We are going to be rich. And all you, I mean we, have to do is to take possession of the saloon. By the way, why have you got plaster all over your clothes?
Oh, well, I thought it was a spaghetti western.
That's time, gentlemen, please. Ta-la, Will Our Pete, take care of yourselves, won't you? Time, gentlemen, please, come along. Ain't you got no ranches to go to then, eh?
Did you see something, Harry?
Give us one good reason why I should let you stay after time, eh? Eh? That's a good enough reason. Excuse me a moment, I'm needy down in the basement.
Hello, boys. So, who are you boys?
We're the Thompson twins.
Twins, eh? Well, happy families.
Hey, are you Miss Bette Noir, owner of this here saloon?
In the flesh.
Say, can you tell us who's a regular gambler in this joint?
I don't know, but I'll bet you five don't want it isn't me. Run along home now, boys. Harry?
Yeah. Have they gone yet?
That's what I love about you, Harry. You don't know the meaning of the word fear.
Yeah, look. It says here in the paper that the Union Pacific Railway is going to bypass East Clintwood because the town isn't big enough.
But they must come here.
Well, why?
Well, we already built the station. Oh, if only the town were a bit richer, they'd have to come here.
I'm just going to collect my new hat now, Miss Bet.
Okay, Melody.
You're good to that girl, Miss Bet. Treat her like your own daughter.
Maybe that's because I miss my son so much. But that's not important now. We must think about the town. Unless the mayor can do something about the railroad, East Clintwood is lost.
Now, here's my plan for getting rid of the saloon and laying our hands on all that gold. It can't go wrong.
Will the mayor get his hands on the gold? Or will Bette Noir find out about it first? Will she ever find her long-lost son? And who is the masked stranger? Find out in next week's episode of Ricochet.
Shirt on the back of your head. What are you doing?
I'm trying to wash Lee's shirt.
Oh, yeah, who's Lee?
He's a singer with imagination. Uh-huh. He's coming here to get his shirt.
Yeah, why is that?
Because of Barbara Streisand.
Oh, I see. You went to the cinema and you had a hot dog and got mustard all down his shirt. You've done that before, haven't you?
Yeah. And if you see Errol and Ashley,
yeah,
say nothing.
Yeah, well, I don't know who they are, so I'm not likely to say anything, you see. Kim, you're dripping all over the floor.
I'll go and dry it.
Why don't you go and dry it?
I'll go and dry it.
Good idea.
Dawn, could you just put three or four words down on there, please, love?
What for?
Wait a minute. All will be revealed, I tell you. Okay, just that's it. Lovely.
Okay,
Ethel, lovely. If you could be so good as to write your life story on that postcard in a minute, and I'll be back.
Okay. Life story on a postcard? I don't think that much has happened to me. Cheeky thing.
Ethel, you wanted someone to help you with your career?
Yes.
Well,
Jenny, Ethel, Ethel, Jenny. Good luck, love.
How do you do?
How can you help me choose a career?
Well, I gather that you're a little bit indecisive and a little bit dithery.
How do you know that?
Through your handwriting.
Can you analyse handwriting?
Yes. Well, I try to.
What's that called?
That's called graphology.
And you're a graphologist,
yes,
are you?
Yes,
well,
I am.
Where'd you get? Has Harold been in my bedroom?
Well, Harry Gay, I gather that he managed to pinch a bit from you.
I don't know that boy.
Saved it for me.
Tell me, it's here. Yes. What, this is my handwriting.
Well,
what have you told about
me? You're discriminating. Did you know that? Mm-hmm. You size people up astutely.
Well, yes.
And your intelligence is high, and you think clearly.
No, I don't think that.
You have a penetrating mind.
Yeah. How can you tell all these things?
From your handwriting.
Let's go have a look. Now, this is the piece of handwriting that you have.
You need to fulfil your ambitions as well, yes?
That's so true, yes. Isn't it? I need to fulfil my ambitions.
Yes, you do, actually.
How
yes.
do you approach it? If you've got a piece of paper like this with handwriting on, how do you approach analysing
it? You mean you want me to tell you all my secrets?
Not all of them, just some of them, please.
Well, the dominance, for example, rising lines, falling lines, the size of the writing.
Yeah, can you point to anything in particular?
Yes, I can point to your zones. I can point to your upper zones there.
Yeah.
And your upper zones there. And your lower zones.
Which
there.
Mean what?
All sorts of things, but the upper zones is your intelligence and your imagination.
Mm-hmm.
The middle zone is your social and material, and the lower zone is the physical, emotional, and other things.
And other bits and pieces. What does it mean that all my handwriting slopes to one side? Is that important?
That's
the fact
good.
That it goes
you're
to
a right slanter, and that is positive.
Why is that good?
Because it means you're a daddy's girl and you follow the father figure and respect and recognise male dominance.
So what does it mean if the handwriting goes the other way and it goes to the left?
Well, it means that they follow the mother figure or they go back to mum. It's not quite as positive.
So would you encourage
people? Well, in the past. No, I wouldn't. I'd encourage them to write to the right.
Always. So
always.
You've got kids of your own?
Yes.
And do you encourage them to write?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So it really reflects your personality, the writing?
Yes, it really does.
Well, does that mean that if I consciously decided I was going to write in a different way, do you think that would change my personality?
It would help. I mean, eventually it would become automatic, and that would help its training of the brain and its perseverance of. Yeah. Yes.
What other things can you tell? Could you tell anything about health or
I can.
Like
you look pretty healthy, by the way.
Thank you very much.
Know
from
that?
My writing?
Oh, yes. It's quite healthy stuff.
Thank goodness for that. It's safe me going to the doctor's.
You need to fulfil your ambitions.
Yes.
And expound your views and everything. You're very good at sorting out other people, listening to their problems.
What about if there was something wrong with me? What could you tell from my handwriting?
Well, if it was very serious, I'd tell you to have a check-up and go to the doctor.
But like what? What sort of things?
Heart trouble and organic disturbance.
What about people with, criminal tendencies?
Oh, well, I tell them in a very nice way, but I tell them that I wouldn't tell them to go to the doctor.
Very good idea. But have you ever been asked to investigate on any
crimes?
Yes,
I have. I have for dishonest, if you like, employees, and I have. But I do that very rarely now. But there are a lot of graphologists that do that.
So if you applied for a job or something, somebody might use a graphologist
yes,
to
they
investigate
might well
your
do.
Application?
Yes, especially if it's a very important job holding on to a lot of money. Or not holding on to a lot of money.
How long would it take you to do an ordinary analysis of
Oh, hours and hours and hours, about 6-8 hours.
So it's not mumbo-jumbo at all? It's proper science?
No, it's character analysis. The only thing I don't do is sort of forgery.
Yeah.
That's a different job again.
Hello. Hiya. Are Leee, Errol or Ashley?
No, I'm Errol.
I'm Ashley.
Oh, right. Listen, have you got any samples of handwriting? Because Jenny is a graphologist. Got a foot with you, that would be lovely.
Oh, how wonderful.
Thank you
so much.
What can you tell from those?
Oh, very lively. Wonderful sense of humour. Haven't you got a wonderful
sense of humour? Definitely. I must get to know you.
Footloose and fancy.
I could say that you have very exciting fantasies, rather wild.
I don't wish to hear about... No, I don't think we wish to hear about that. If you want a proper analysis, I think you better take Jenny with you, because...
Errol, I think we should take her away.
Come with me.
She's got to come.
Bye.
That'll cheer her up. Cheer her up. Is that quite good? No. Listen, if you've got some samples of handwriting, perhaps we'd get Jenny to do yours later on. That'd be good, wouldn't it? So bearing in mind what she said, let's see, what she said was discriminating, intelligent, I don't know about that, good with people. I wonder if that will help me choose my career, but I still can't quite decide, you know.
What did you do after you left school, then?
Well, when I was 17 and I left school, I went and worked in a factory canteen. I was called Ethel Spoon in those days because I used to spoon out the gravies and the custards, but I got fired from that.
What was that, then?
Yeah, well, I put gravy on the apple pie and custard on the steak and kidney and people weren't too strong. Anyway, then I went to become a club secretary in a boxing club and that was great, and then I was very lucky and I came into some money and I bought number 73. So that kept me busy for a while. And then I thought... Well, I really want to do something else with my life. So I was make addresses for a mail order company at home and I was doing envelopes. That's how I got to know Fred, actually. And I did lots of jobs like that, but I don't know, none of them were really satisfying, you know. So, but bearing in mind what Jenny said, I think I might have come up with something.
What is it then?
Well, I think I'm going to go into politics.
before.
Yeah. But not as big as the Prime Minister, you know. Not somebody suggested that, but not quite.
An MP?
No, not an MP. I'm going to stand for the local council, be a councillor.
Oh, that's terrific. Yeah. What's a councillor?
A councillor, somebody looks after, you know, local interests.
Oh, so you're looking after us?
I'm looking after you already. No, looks after the community. I'm going to stand for election.
Oh. Yeah, what party are you going to be? SDP?
Oh, no.
Labour?
No.
Liberal?
No.
Conservative?
No.
Then what?
I'm going to be an independent.
Oh, that's terrific.
Yeah.
That's outrageous.
Do you think it's outrageous? I don't think it's that outrageous.
Outrageous? I couldn't agree with you more. Me and Fred sharing that room?
No,
terrible.
I'm not talking about that.
What?
Ethel's going to be an independent councillor.
Telling me a lie.
Tell me that again.
Ethel's going to be an independent councillor.
Ethel's going to be an independent councillor. Oh, no. Oh, Ethel, there's only one problem in that, love.
What?
You'll never make any money out of it.
I'm not doing it for the money.
Jack, another 150, please.
Underpants? What happened to the last lot?
I've sold them all, haven't I, Ethel? Yes, business is what you might call booming. Anyone want to buy a microwave?
Yeah, you sell my microwave.
Hey, you! Oh, Ethel, what are you trying to say to me, eh? That the best things in life are free?
They are.
That is such nonsense. You show me a free bottle of champagne in a free room in the best hotel, and then I'll believe you.
Do you know, Harry, you've made me realise something.
What?
It is precisely people like you, small-minded businessmen with thoughts only for money and none for the community, that I intend to campaign against. And that campaign begins now. Kids, to the loo. I'm Ethel Davis. I'm standing for the local council.
I'm Lee John.
Oh, yes. You're looking for somebody?
I'm looking for Kim.
Oh, do you live in this area?
You must be joking.
Then I'm wasting my time. Come in anyway.
Thank you so
Kim,
much.
Lee, say nothing.
Hello, Kim. Oh. My shirt.
Yes, you're here, Lee.
Yes, I'm here.
Yes, it's coming along lovely.
What do you mean, lovely?
Well, lovely. Did you enjoy the movie last night?
What movie? I want to know about my shirt.
I love the pictures, don't you?
I love the pictures too, but what about my shirt?
Airplane, Gone with the Wind, Towering Inferno.
Towering Inferno. My burning shirt!
No, it's not burning, it's just the mustard coming out.
What mustard? Look at my...
Oh, look, the stain's gone too.
Thank you very much, Kim. Thank you so much.
Here, Jack, about this ships in bottles stock that you sold me, mate, there's nothing in it. Oh, it's the Marie Celeste. Oh, great, love it. He's a boy, that, Jack, I'll show you. Come, dear.
Watch Harry.
Hello, Dawn, I mean, not Ethel. News, my love.
What's that?
Ethel is going to stand as the local councillor. Can you believe that?
Councillor?
Yeah.
She said something about a job and she was talking about councillors
she
early.
She is going to do it. She's going to stand in the local election.
Oh, good for her.
Well, Ethel as a local councillor, Dawn, have a Marie Celeste.
Why not, I say? Why not?
Tracker.
Oh, Lindsay, well done. Where was he? Hello, Tracker.
Oh, he's asleep in the shed.
Was he? Oh, come on. Colin, we found Tracker.
Oh, jolly good. Where'd you find him?
In the shed.
He's
asleep.
Having a kick as usual. He's working hard, was he?
Boy, yeah. Hello, Dabble.
Are you getting on with the competition, Russell?
Oh, it's all right, but all the questions, you know, got all the questions around the outside about safety and law, and let alone the murder ones. I can't seem to get bike ones this week.
Can't you? Well, I'll tell you what, why don't you, you know, I'll give you a hand if you tell me what they are.
Hey, there's no cheating. This is legit. You know, you can't give him a hand, no. But if you're lucky, he might give you a few tips in a minute.
Okay, you're doing the competition, Lindsay.
Yeah, it's a great competition, but the only trouble is the entries have got to be in by May the 31st.
May the 31st?
Yeah.
Ah, well, where do you get these entry forms from, eh?
Well, you can get them, you can send off to them at the Supersleuth competition.
Yeah.
Midland Bank, PLC, Sheffield, PO Box 2, S13GG.
No, I didn't quite get that. Can you say it again for me, please?
Yes.
Right.
Supersleuth competition.
Yeah.
Midland Bank, PLC, Sheffield, PO Box 2, yeah. S13GG.
Right, I got that. I can just see us now,
yeah.
Flying across the Atlantic.
Yeah.
Best gear, roller skates by my side. Yeah. Staying at the Waldorf.
Yeah.
Seeing Manhattan.
Yeah.
Broadway. The lights.
Light.
TJ Hooker in a helicopter.
Yeah.
A guest of the Secret Service.
Hey, hey, you're getting carried away. You're too old.
Oh, this stop.
It's 11 to 16-year-olds. Boys and girls, 11 to 16.
Oh, that's not... Well, what are you doing, Sherlock, apart from making a mess?
OK, well, before you rudely interrupted me, I was just postcoding old Fred's bike. He asked me to do it while he's got it in for a pit stop here.
Mm. Postcoding? What does that mean?
Well, it's a new scheme the Home Office and police have come out with for marking property. It's a pretty good idea. It's a security idea, you know, that if, in the event of you having property stolen, not only bikes, but then cameras and radios and so on, you've got a very good chance of getting them back, you know.
Well, how do you do it? Why don't you show us?
Well, what you do is you put a postcode on it, which is, of course, the first two letters, say, our postcode at Kent, which I'll show you, actually, is, as you know, the ME156RS, right?
Yeah.
And I was just completing that, actually, and I'm finishing it with the house number, which, of course, here is a 7...
And a three.
That's
course.
It. And
Can anyone get this done?
Well, no, they can't really. It's quite expensive gear. But I tell you what, the crime prevention officers, they're very helpful and they're the experts. They can tell you where you can get it done.
Your local, you can go to them.
Local police or the town hall and the road safety officers. You know,
well, I think I'm going to get that done to my bike.
Yeah. Could I say, dogs, if you lose your bike as much as I do, you know, like going to school, going with mates, even shopping for dad.
Yeah.
Because my bike's becoming really popular with all my friends.
Well, of course, yeah, and you know, it is becoming popular. Did you know there's National Bike Week this week?
Is it?
Yeah, it starts today.
Great.
Yeah,
what's that all about then?
Well, it starts today, as I say, and it goes on for a whole week, and it's been organised by the Royal Society of Prevention and Accidents, and it's the idea is to give people a focus on bikes.
And they do all sorts of things, rides, and that's great.
Safety and so on.
Well, how do you get the number?
I don't know. How do you get a number?
Well, I suppose you go to your library, don't you? Go to the library and look it up in the directory.
That's right, that's right.
Well, how are all these people riding bikes? I hope they're doing it properly.
Well, in fact, Dawn, it's a good point you bring up there, because a lot of them don't. In fact, over 2,000 kids were seriously injured or killed in 1 year.
Oh, that's a lot.
Yeah.
Well, why does this happen?
Well, a lot of kids are not really sort of paying attention to the proficiency tests, you know, which are held by the road safety officers, and they don't look where they're going at road junctions, particularly when they're turning right, you know, they get into sort of difficulties and so on.
Well, how do you turn right properly then?
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll show you, shall I?
Okay.
Okay, yeah. Well, the basic idea is, imagine this is a bike, okay, and I'm 10 years younger, and I'm cycling home from school, right?
Yeah.
Here I go. Now, the first important thing is to look behind you, right?
Yeah.
Right,
it's clear, so I'm going to signal. But not like that, or, you know, like that. You know, a clear signal. Right, a clear signal like that. And then as you come up to the junction, you're in the centre of the road, right? Mm-hmm. Now, the important thing is the lifesaver. Before you turn, you look again over your shoulder. There it is. What's he doing, you see? You've got to be aware of the unexpected.
Yeah.
So when you're turning right, before you turn, you look again. Called the lifesaver.
Yeah.
Right?
Now, I've got a little surprise for you, Colin.
Oh, yes.
Lindsay, get the blind projector. Well, I know you like a good laugh,
not
right?
Not winding me up.
And I've found this very silly film about bicycles, especially for you.
Oh.
Now, Russell, you're going to like this.
Racing?
Because
right.
It's got bikes that you used to use, you know, penny farthing.
Hey, that's that good. Yeah, it's not at all funny, that is
that was funny. Here we are. I want to ride my bicycle. I want to ride my bike. I want to ride my bicycle. I want to ride it where I like. Bicycle, bicycle, bicycle. Daisy, Daisy, give me your answer too. I'm half crazy, all for the love of you. It won't be a stylish marriage. Upon the seat of a bicycle, races are coming.
Around, round, wheels going round, round, round. Down on pedals, down, up, down. But I gotta get across to the other side of town before the sun goes down.
Let's have a ride on your bicycle. Let's have a ride on your bike. She put her bicycle under a tree. I think that girl took a fancy to me. She said to me as we both sat down, tell me what would you like? I said, my dear, if there's nobody near, let's have a ride on your
bicycle.
I want to ride my
bicycle.
I want a
bicycle race.
Hey, there you are.
Good.
Hey, listen, good. Colin, I think you should take your dog for a walk. He's looking a bit
sure.
restless.
Okay, then. Come on in.
After all that sleep. Yeah.
Tracker, come
okay,
on.
Okay, thank you lot. I'll clear out all this mess.
Come on, heel, heel. Come on.
Back in the old country. Back in the
Tom,
old country.
Tom, good grief, I forgot about him.
Stop!
The captain!
Back in the old country. Back in the old country.
I'm here. One, two, three,
one, four, five.
Very good.
Oh, oh yeah. Had a mansion in Earl's Court. He wore a dressing gown and a short tight beard. He showed me pictures of balding cowboys and a chicken with false teeth. Those horseflesh hustlers stood around looking weird. I met a Sid Vicious lookalike, and he was 6'4".
You see, you probably didn't know this, but Leee reckons he's a real boffin on the golden age of Hollywood.
What do you mean, reckon?
Well, we'll soon see, because I've got some photographs for you here. And I'm going to ask you a few questions about them, see what you really know.
A few questions.
Who is that?
Oh, come on, everybody knows. That's Gene Kelly.
Yes, correct.
That's right, he was in Singing in the Rain, just singing in the rain.
Yes,
he's a choreographer. He was on television the other day in Evel Knievel, and he also directed bits of Xanadu with Olivia Newton-John. Very talented man, all the steps.
He is, wasn't he?
Him and Fred Astaire are my favourites.
Now.
Oh, Judy!
Lovely lady, look. She's also a famous mum, isn't she?
Yeah, if you know Liza Minnelli, you know, Liza with a Z, not Liza with an S, you know, that's Judy
now,
Garland's mum.
What was her most famous film?
Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high.
Wizard of Oz.
We're off to see the wizard. That's definitely.
And this is...
Don't know why there's no sun up in the sky, stormy weather.
Yeah, but who is it, Leee?
Oh, sorry. Too much in myself, you know what I mean? Lena Horne. She, talking about wizards, she was also in The Wiz with Diana Ross and Michael Jackson.
Oh,
He's on Dan.
I just thought she was a singer, isn't that funny?
No, she was an actress. She did so many, you know, beautiful things. She reminds me of my grandmother.
Now, what are your favourite kind of films?
I love musicals. I love the Busby Barclay. My fantasy is to come down a white staircase with beautiful girls on each side and putting on the top hat if you know where you go to. I mean, I've got so much stuff at home. Lots of music, lots of books on the film world and everything. Probably, darling, you and me can get together one day.
Oh, don't you think there's a lot of romance missing
definitely.
Out
Definitely. I could be Rhett Butler and you could be Scarlett O'Hara.
Oh, Rhett. Oh, Rhett.
Come here, darling.
Yes, well, anyway, we've got a picture of him in here. Yeah, we've got a picture of our neighbour.
He's at it again.
Oh, no, really?
Showing off.
No, my friend. I don't mind. Listen, I've got to really apologise to all of you for all this inconvenience.
And my shirt.
I'm so embarrassed. But let me make it up to you. I can sing a bit.
You can sing a bit?
Yeah, I can. No, I can.
Okay, then. Let me think in my memory. Why don't you try a song?
All right, an audition.
That's right.
Okay.
Get happy.
Get happy.
Yes, get
Do
happy.
Do I know get happy?
She knows get
she
happy.
Knows it.
Do
she
I
must
know get happy?
Citizens of Maidstone, fourscore and ten
year... Be yourself.
That's
history.
I'll
be
up to date. Hang on. Now, listen here, brothers. No.
Be yourself, Ethel.
Citizens of
that's
Maidstone.
It, that's good.
I often ask, why do I stand here?
Here, here.
Why do I stand here, here? Well, I tell you, I stand for...
Nothing.
Stand for nothing. Citizen...
Old letterbox mouth up there. Fred! Is it? He's not, he can't be for real. He is an alien. He is not of this world. Ethel, he's gotta go!
Harry, I will decide who stays and who goes. Unless you've got something useful to contribute to the campaign, you may depart.
Okay. I think I might have something useful for you. I just might be able to help you,
I don't need your help. I've got the kids' help.
Ethel, have you thought about who's going to do your leaflets?
Have we thought about who's going to do...
Photographs?
Have we thought about the...
Posters?
Have we thought about the... Probably a bit more to this than I realised.
Right. Now, your leaflets, I can do them.
Yes.
Your posters, I can do them. Your photographs, I can do them.
Yes.
Your speeches,
yes.
You can do them.
OK, I'll make a speech and you set up a photograph.
Right. Now, now, can
just
I just
frame
improvise?
It, frame it up.
Right.
OK, here we go. Citizens of Maidstone, you often ask, why do I step... What's that noise?
That's the click of my camera.
Oh, I see. OK. Citizens of Maidstone... What's that noise? Somebody's in the cellar in your underpants!
Oh no, someone's opening your rhubarb wine! Ah.
Hey you! Hey you! Cellar again. I'm sure they're opening my rhubarb wine.
What?
I said I'm sure they're opening my rhubarb wine.
I just hope they're not going through my underpants, that's all.
What's that other noise?
I think it's coming from the kitchen.
Troubles, come on, get out.
I think we'll give you a go.
Yeah, what are we gonna do?
Not only that, we may do a new single in the state of love, if you're good enough, that is. What do you think, fellas?
Let's go and tell the band, shall we?
Yeah, I think give her a try, yeah.
Let's go and tell the band.
She's not bad, really, is she?
No, not bad, really.
Hey, guys, not too much of that rhubarb wine, right? And I've got customers for those underpants.
You mean knickers?
Cheek. Great. Hiya. Do you know what? I knew I could make this thing work. I knew I could make a living out of selling underpants and a projector. Oh, look, I know it's only underpants and a projector, but if you can make money out of them, there's nothing wrong with that, is there? And hey, listen, I'm not going to blow that money on having a good time, you know? No, no, no. I'm ploughing it all back into the bank to go into some further education business. Yep. Harry Stern, things are looking up.
Seasons of a Maidstone. I'll try again. Hang on a minute. Citizens
no,
of...
No, you've got a favour, small Ethel.
Yeah, and what about my clothes and things? You see, the thing is, I just can't seem to decide anything. I can't decide how to present myself. I can't decide what to wear. I can't decide anything, really. I'm no good at decisions.
We'll help you.
Yeah?
Right. For example,
yes.
What tail do you like? This one's quite nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, but this one's more colourful, isn't it?
I can't decide.
I'll tell you what. Throw them up in the end. Yeah. First one, the one that lands first,
right.
You like.
Okay. Okay, go ahead. Right. That one landed first. I like it, but it's a bit dirty now. Oh, okay, that's one decision. All right. Let's see. Who's going to decide who's going to wash the bath?
Okay,
there we go.
Idea.
Right. Yeah.
Go like this.
Yes.
You go one, two, three, up.
Yeah.
And you've got to have your palms facing that way or that way.
Yes.
And the one with the odd one out.
Yes.
Has to clean the bathroom. Right.
Oh, seems reasonable. Okay, another decision to go. One, two, three, up. Oh, terrific. It's me cleaning the bath. That's wonderful. Huh. So I clean the bath, I have a bath, and then I have to decide what to wear to the political meeting. Now, shall I wear a dress or shall I wear trousers?
Well, if it lands on the blue side,
yes,
you wear trousers.
Right.
If it lands on the pink side, you wear a dress.
This takes the sweat out of decision making, doesn't it? This is wonderful. Okay, blue for trousers, pink for a dress.
Ready?
Yep.
Blue.
I'm going to wear trousers. Ah, final question. Should I go to all the political meetings? Some of them? None of them? Which, what should I do?
Well, there's another one.
Yeah?
You put your hands on the broom.
Yeah?
And that one's maybe.
Yeah?
That one's no, and that one's yes.
Okay.
You work your way up there, and the last one...
Let's see where we go. Okay. Shall I go to all the political meetings?
Yeah. Maybe.
Yes.
No.
Maybe.
Yes.
No.
Maybe.
Yes.
No! Oh, I won't go to any of them. I think we better do it again. Have another go. Shall I go...
Yes.
Stop? Yes. Maybe.
Maybe.
No.
Yes.
Maybe.
No.
Yes.
Maybe.
No, I'm not going to go to any of the political meetings. I'll tell you one thing I've decided. That's kind of got me into a routine of deciding things. I have decided that I'm not going to let you in on my deepest political secrets. Could you find something else to do?
Now, I think he's great. Yeah, I have some water, Tracker.
Yeah,
you know. They are. Go on, mate. If you don't drink it, I will. Yeah. Hey, these used to be used in the police force. Oops, I'm sliding all over the place. These used to be used in the police force, didn't they?
That's right. Yeah, that's right. It's going back a bit. About 1829 when the police were first used, they used to use them, but not now, of course.
I think I'm right.
That's right. A bit redundant now. Yeah, more onto German shepherds.
The last time I saw a dog like this was in Sherlock Holmes.
Yeah, don't call me Sherlock.
Oh, right. Don't get so touchy. Just don't bring up the projector business.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm sorry about the old projector.
Yes,
yeah, I was out of order there.
Yeah.
It was so old hat. Though, wasn't it? I mean,
yes.
Didn't think you bought it. It was out of fashion, wasn't it? Huh?
What do you mean out of? I mean, proved that it worked last week, Sleuth.
What?
And if you don't believe me, I'm going to pull the blind, and I'll show you.
I bet it didn't work this
time. Do you want me to take the dog?
Go.
Yeah. Now look, Mr. Sleuth, or may I call you Super?
Okay.
Press that button.
Right.
All right. Now I'll prove to you that it works. Right.
Five.
Four. Three. Two. One. Here we go.
He's our man, hero of our nation. For his adventures, just be sure and stay tuned to this station. So come and join us, all you kids. for lots of fun and laughter as Roger and Jet and his men get all the crooks they're after. Roger and Jet, he's our man, hero of our nation. For his adventures, just be sure and stay tuned to this station.
As this essential episode begins, we find one of the American Eagles with a very big problem.
Hey, what's going on here? What's happened? Turn the sun back on. Hey, you're a dog. A big dog. A nifty keen type dog.
Yeah. Bark, yeah, etc.
Where is your master? Oh, you poor guy. You mean you don't have no home?
No.
Gee, I wish I could take you home with me, but I can't. Roger Ramjet is allergic to dogs. They make him sneeze and his eyes water.
Ooh, not too bad.
But maybe I could sneak you home for a while, just long enough to feed you something.
Yeah, steak.
And so Doodle decided to try his plot.
Doodle, did you bring another dog home? You know I can't be around dogs. They make me... Get him out of here.
But, Roger, the poor little guy's hungry.
Out! I know you love dogs, and I do, too.
Yeah, me too.
But I can't spend the rest of my life sneezing.
I'm sorry, fella. We tried.
Yeah. Freezing. Runny nose. I get warm. Get out here warm. Thanks.
Ah, the poor guy. But tears could not be shed on a poor dog. There was hero work to be done.
Hello, Ramjet here.
Ramjet, there's been a disaster. We need your help.
Of course, General. What is it?
A huge network of foreign spies is in Washington. They've stolen the FBI and the CIA and the USO.
Mercy, the CIO may be next. Or the UAW. Or even the CPM.
What's that?
Cost per thousand.
Oh, of course.
I'll get right on it. Come on, gang. We've got work to do.
One for all and all for one. The Eagles fly till the job is done.
What's wrong with my plane?
One huge, fat, lethargic dog. He was so heavy, he was weighing the plane down.
Hey, what the flea are you doing here?
Cold.
Oh, boy.
Ramjet to squadron. What's wrong, Doodle?
My plane don't fly so good. You guys go on. I'll bring up the rear.
Roger.
And so the faster American Eagles arrived in Washington in a thrice.
Now, where do you suppose the spies are hiding out?
Well, this is a treasure. Not only have we captured all the government's secret plans, we've even captured Roger Ramjet and the American Eagles. We'll take them all back to our country, tie them up and start the plane, but not simultaneously.
You're so heavy, dog, that we had to use more gas. We're all out now and we'll have to bail out. Come on. Quick, big fella. The squadron is in trouble. After them.
Now to put back the stolen buildings. The FBI, CIA, USO, UJA, CBS, ROP, UFO, NBC, ARB, ABC...
Boy, fella, you sure were a nifty hero. And just for that, Roger is letting us keep you. Aren't you, Roger?
That's right, gang. Any hero friend of Doodle's is a hero friend of mine.
And so, once again, thanks to the cunning and ingenuity of Roger Ramjet, the world is a nicer place in which to live at. Yet...
There you are. I told you it's working. Yep.
Okay, so you were right about the projector, but I'm now going to investigate your underpants.
What? Do you know what? I've got a feeling he doesn't trust me. Nobody trusts me around here.
Hey, Harry.
Yeah?
You know that stuff you're planning to sell at the market next week?
Oh, yeah.
Well, the band are using it as bunting in the cellar.
What?
What did I say?
In a state of love, in a state of love, in a state of love.
I can put it here, can't I?
No,
it's the right place.
No, of course you can't. You put it on the bike frame, you know?
Why can't I put it here?
Well, it's far better to put it on the frame.
They won't see it if I put it here, will they?
Well, that's not the point. That's...
Excuse me. Hello, Maester 600 000. Hello. You'd like, who's that? I can't hear you, Helen. Can you speak out? Is that?
It's Helen Clarkson.
Helen Clarkson, I got that. What do you want?
We live by Berry Main Road. My parents say that I should cycle on the pavement until I pass my cycle proficiency test. But my brother was told not to by a policeman. So I'd like to know, can you cycle on the pavement? And also, where can I get details on the cycling proficiency test?
Now, I'm going to have to pass you over to the expert because I think you better deal with this.
Right.
About cycling on the pavement.
Oh, right. Hello there, Helen. Yes, I heard the gist of the question and cycling on the pavement. Well, of course, the general ruling on this is youngsters are quite permitted to ride on the pavement. But, of course, if you've got an adult-type bike or you're an older child, well, then obviously you should be cycling on the road or on cycle lanes, which are designed for that. But Helen, can I mention one particular point you raised really with your question, is that one of the biggest causes of accidents with kids on bikes is, in fact, when they leave the pavement and join the road. The road safety officers were telling me just recently that that's where a lot of people have a lot of accidents, when they go from the pavement straight into the road without looking. OK? Anyway, Tracker's calling me now. I've got to go. He's got himself stuck in a fence. Anyway, thanks for calling, Helen. Bye-bye.
Hiya,
somebody
famous on the
floor? The councillor. No, there was
nobody famous. Nobody at all?
No,
because I need somebody famous, you see, to help me with my campaign. Do you know anybody famous?
Well, the Shaw Taylor, my mate Shaw Taylor. You know, he could...
You don't know Shaw Taylor.
He's my
mate. No, come on, suggest somebody.
Donald Duck.
No, somebody less animated.
I've got a good idea. This is serious.
Yeah.
The other day, when I was down at the hypermarket, I bumped into Brian Cant. Now, he would be great because he lives locally.
Kids love him.
Kids like him. Yeah. And he's friendly.
Do you think he would?
Yeah.
Look his number up for me.
I think that's a great idea.
How would I approach him? I go, hello, Brian. My name's Ethel
Davis.
No,
that's far too formal. It's got to be more friendly.
Hi, Brian. Name's Eth. How are you doing?
No, that's far too casual.
Yeah. What then?
Just think you've seen him across the road, okay? And you're going to...
Hey, you!
Hey, you! Hey, you!
I told you, he's that sort of bloke.
Oh, isn't that wonderful?
He's just that sort of person.
And where did you meet him in the hypermarket, was
it? Yeah. I just bumped into him. I'd be trolley. It's full of groceries. I bumped straight into
him. Oh, I do hope he's going to...
I thought a bit embarrassed because he's a bit famous.
Excuse me, Dawn. Oh. Thank you, love. Now, that's, let me see, 6 dozen of white underpants, 3 dozen of blue, and three dozen
Harry,
of green.
Harry, where are you storing all this stuff?
Well, there's 3 dozen under the sink, 3 dozen behind the sofa, and the 6 dozen upstairs in your bedroom, OK?
In my bedroom? Harry, you don't understand. I'm standing for election. I've got an image to maintain. What happens if the press find out I've got 2 dozen pairs of comedy men's underpants under my bed?
Well, don't let the press into your bedroom, Ethel.
I'm not going to let the press into my bedroom. I'm not going to let you into my bedroom.
OK, I think I'll just store them leaflets I'm making you out in the yard.
Oh, that's nice, where they get all wet. I want them in the house.
Oh, I think what we're trying to say is that you can store your stuff in the house, I can't store my stuff in the house, can I?
Harold, it's my house. This isn't a business. Okay, I'm standing
for
election.
I had this all last week, you know. This is great.
Now, listen, come on, you two. I can sort this all out, right? Why don't I use my old delivery van to help you, Ethel, deliver your leaflets and with your campaign and that stuff, and you, Harry, to take your stuff away and solve your problem of storage. What about it?
Hang on a minute, I just have to decide. Excuse me a second. 1, 2, 3. Yeah, oh, that's fine.
Harry?
1, 2, hey, yeah, fine, sure, great.
That's great, isn't it? Come on, let's go and load up your underpants.
I'm not sure if I'm having a good day today. I can't really decide.
Oh, hold on!
Come on!
Ethel, Brian!
Brian, Ethel, that's it,
Do you know that? Colin. Oh, how you do? Oh, Brian, I'm so glad you've come. That's so wonderful.
That's all right. That's
now, listen,
all nice.
Let me just explain what it is, you see. I need a celebrity to help me boost my campaign, give me a bit of, you know, a bit of hype.
You're going into counselling, yeah.
Yeah, but listen, before you do that, did you get me the chicken for the sandwich?
Of course I got the chicken for the sandwich.
Did you get a dressed one?
Oh, come on. Of course I got your dressed one. Great. There it is. Look at that. Isn't it sweet? She's got little leg warmers. Yeah, it's like Leroy. And this, you see this thing here, isn't that lovely?
Yeah, that's a tutu.
No, that's a four. Well, two twos are four.
Why has it got a... What's it got in there? It's a torch.
Yeah, yeah, well, that's because it's a battery hen, you see. Oh. Yeah, yeah, that's that.
Yes. I need your help.
Yes.
Because I'm not quite sure. You're good at public speaking, meeting people. I've never really had any experience. Yes. How do I approach it? What's the best way to go about it?
You don't want to do the old political speech bit, do you know?
No,
you know,
no. Who... No,
why don't you try... I tell you what. Mm. Why don't you try grabbing them with a few gags?
Yeah, like
few well... Oh, if I thought I could have brought my Groucho outfit, we could have done
teach you a
few classic Groucho gags.
So,
grab them, then you can do what you like.
Cigar!
Hey, that should be good.
I've got some tape. No, I haven't got the glasses. I'm sorry about that.
I've got iron, actually.
OK, well, what do I have to do?
Well, I'll tell you what.
OK, ready?
Yeah.
Doctor, I'm a little horse.
How long have you been a little horse? 3 years, huh?
Okay.
That's good.
Doctor, I've got this pain.
Oh, how long have you had it before?
Yes.
You got it again?
Doctor, I've got this itch.
An itch there? Well, that's your appendix. I'll have to take it out.
Take it out for an itch?
Yeah, well, if I take it out, you can scratch it.
Doctor, it hurts when I do this.
Well, don't do that.
Doctor, I've got this sick eye.
A sick eye? You seeing anybody with it?
No, I look out the other one.
That's good. No, I mean, are you seeing anybody for it? With
what
a sick
would I
eye?
See for a sick eye?
The psychiatrist.
Hey! That's not bad, is it?
That's all right. See, you're doing well. That's it, you're smiling already. You're not worrying.
How did you learn these things? How did you learn about jokes?
How did you learn them? Well, I don't know about learning about jokes. Well, being an actor, you have to learn about jokes. Yeah. I've been doing a tour with Jonathan Cohen, fifth year running, going around all the theatres.
Yeah, did you learn any good jokes?
A lot of... At the end of each show, we have... look at me talking with this sort of rubbish.
No, you don't look silly at all.
No. We have some children on stage, you see. I can see if I can remember. Sir. The last week, in fact, yes, one of the last ones. What do you get if you cross a hyena with an OXO cube?
I don't know. What do you get if you cross a hyena with an OXO cube?
A laughing stock. What was that?
Canned laughter.
Ah, yeah, you see, you're there.
Good,
another one. Yes, this was late. I know, yes. Why did Father Christmas get himself a garden?
I don't know. Why did Father Christmas get himself a garden?
So he could ho, ho, ho. Yeah, they like that as well.
I don't know how I do that. That's terrific. I've got a good gag. Okay. What do you call a chap with a rabbit in each ear and one in his mouth?
I don't know. What do you call a chap with a rabbit in one each ear and one in the mouth?
Warren.
Is that a good hit? Yeah.
I love that. That's great. Where are they? Listen, there's something I must ask you. Why are you growing that?
Hey, you're with it. I'll tell you where. I'll tell you why I'm wearing this.
Yeah, go ahead.
Because I'm starting a play with Granada, a series with Granada. Well, it's just a bit of a secret at the moment. I got there on Monday. Yes.
Wonderful. Yeah. Good luck with that. Are you doing anything else?
Yeah, Sunday night. I'm doing something very, very important. Yes. It's a show for Variety Club.
Oh, they're wonderful. Yeah. They raise a lot of money, don't they?
£3.5 million last year.
Really? Mm-hmm. What are you doing for them?
Well, it's a show at Blazers at Windsor. Phone Windsor 56222. And the thing is, it's for Variety Club and it's got the Roly Polies, Michael Barrymore, a load of people there. It's going to be fun.
The Roly Polies are wonderful.
But it's not for children, I might add.
No, I did add. You did add that, yes. Listen, can I have a go?
Yes.
I tell you what.
Oh, you've got one of your own?
I've got one of mine. You asked me some political questions.
Political questions? All right, yes. This is what you've got to do.
Okay.
Right.
Excuse me, Miss Davis.
Yes, what can I do?
Could you please tell me. Why are you standing for the government?
Well, I'm standing for the government because if I sat down, no one would see me.
That's good. Yeah, it's good. Yeah. Oi. Miss, I've just bought this balloon and it cost me 45p. Why are balloons going up?
Well, that'll be inflation.
Inflation, yes!
But WC Fields there was more like, really,
wasn't
it?
Well, that doesn't matter.
Have you got any other suggestions?
You're not going to wear that when you're really doing it,
are you?
No, that's right.
What else about, you know, approaching the crowd in
approaching the crowd. Well, you could play on the crowd a bit.
Yeah.
You could straight off, you could go up and you could say, how do you do? I'm Dr. Ethel B. Hackenbush, FRCS, MA, PhD, which is a funny way to spell Hackenbush.
Oh, I like that. Yes, that's good. Yes.
Or you could pick a woman out of the crowd and you could say, that's a lovely dress, madam. I'm not doing the right. That's a lovely dress, madam.
That's a lovely dress, madam.
Is that a sari or a sarong? Yeah? Neither? I'm sorry, I was sarong.
I'm sorry, I was sarong.
Good. Make a few up. You're good at it. Where have you gone?
I've gone over here. Hold on.
Hello.
Lee, Ethel, Brian.
Brian, Ethel, Lee.
Hello, Lee.
Hang on a minute. Hello, what's going on
Hello,
here?
Brian.
I'm doing a sandwich quiz. No, I'm not doing it today because I've got a bit of a dodgy
Oh, yes, you are.
What? So, the leering, dazzling, death defying it all. There is envy, the intellectual, delicate, testable, divinely decadent. Sandwich. Oh,
this is all this.
I've dropped all my currants. Talk amongst yourselves. I'll be just one moment. Here we go. Okay, here come the currants and here come the plates. Thank goodness we've got a bit of technology to keep ourselves organised.
Like
okay,
it.
Welcome along to Sandwich Quiz. Could I have your name, please?
Mama Maloney.
Hey, Mama Maloney. Blaine. Okay, welcome. Could I have your name, please?
Brian the Canto.
Ah, Brian the Canto. We got the Brian the Canto playing and a Mama Maloney.
That's
okay.
Right. Uh-huh.
Here we go. Oh, good start. The bread and butter questions are covered in chocolate.
Chocolate spread. Lovely.
Mm, delicious. Okay.
Oh, you can't lick it.
Oh, can't beat that. Now then, open question. Either of you can answer.
Yeah.
If you, I'm covered in
right,
chocolate.
Yeah. Right.
If you get the question right, you get a piece of bread and butter. That's the first round to you. Grab your knives. If you think you know the answer to the question, bang the hilt on the table. There's your knife there, okay, Mama? Okay, here's the first question. Either of you can answer. What did Charles I lose in 1649?
His brains. His head.
I'm sorry, he banged his brain correctly there, Mama. You've got to get it right. He lost his head, absolutely correctly. Okay, you have a choice here. Please, a little bit less exuberance. You can either have a sweet filling, a savoury filling, or a very strange.
I'll have a strange, very.
Okay, we got a very strange. Here we go. This is our very strange filling
to
today.
Mauve. It's very
the first
strange.
Question is, this is just his question. You
okay.
have to let him
yeah.
What is it?
Aubergine.
Absolutely correct. Oh. You get to make an aubergine sandwich. There you go. That's the first sandwich.
Come on, Mama.
Make a sandwich. Okay, get it right quickly because we're next open question. If you haven't put a top on that sandwich by the time I've asked the next question, doesn't count. Okay, open question. Either of you can answer. How many centimetres in a metre?
100.
Absolutely right. Butter sandwich. I'm sorry about no, they're no good. I'm sorry. They'll be a little bit quick, a little bit of reflex action. You think you get a butter sandwich, now you can choose one to go for a filling. So you put that on your plate. What kind of filling are you going to go for? Sweet, savoury, or very strange?
I'm going to go for a sweet.
Okay, you can't go for the filling yet. I've got to take out a little question for you to answer. This is Mama's question. You have to stay stum. Okay.
Mama's got to answer the question.
Come on now, Mama. Go ahead. Okay. What was thrown overboard during the Boston Tea Party?
Tea.
Absolutely. Okay, so quickly, make yourself a sandwich. There we go, on to back to bread and butter. Okay, here's your chance to answer another question. If someone offered you, get that finished before I ask the question, otherwise it won't count. If someone offered you a lentil, would you watch it, read it, or eat it? Yes.
Eat it.
Absolutely correct. Yes, that's right. It's got health food. Eating you there, Mama. Put your top on your sandwich there, otherwise it won't count. Okay, you're going to go for sweet, savoury, or very strange. We're going to have a sweet question.
Ever so sweet.
Okay. What is the largest ocean in the world?
Atlantic.
No, I'm sorry.
Pacific.
It was two
it's
points.
My question.
Just a moment, please. It was not only his question, but the answer was wrong, so you get two sandwiches. Brilliantly done. It was the Pacific. So quickly now, make two sandwiches with the sweet, and we move on to bread and butter. And if you haven't got them down by the time I answer the question, it doesn't count. Is a nom de plume a wine, a feather, or a name?
Name!
A feather.
Name!
A wine!
But I heard it now. Which one was it, Mama or Brian?
I banged it.
I've got a sandwich. That one doesn't count because you hadn't finished it in time. So we have a little bit on there like that. And that's how many sandwiches. How many sandwiches have we got? Let's have a little bit of a count up here. How many have you got, Brian?
Please, cheat.
Four.
How many have you got there, Mama?
Four. I got two, four, six.
No, you've got to be double. One, two, three. Okay, Mama, how many have you got?
Four.
Four. It's three to four. You're going to have to hurry up here. Open question, either of you can
open
answer.
Open question.
Hope you're playing this at home. Is the flag of Great Britain called the Union Jill or the Union Jack?
Jack. Jack.
You're stabbing yourself here. It's called the Union Jack. You're absolutely right. You make a sandwich and tell me if you're going to go for sweet, savoury. Oh, done. Just a moment.
Have you got one called Sticky?
I'm going to go for chocolate.
Okay, you're going to go for sweet, savoury, or very strange?
I'm going to go for chocolate. Let me show you how to make a chocolate.
Okay, just one moment. You've got to answer the question first. Okay, what nationality was the first woman in space?
Russian.
Russian, absolutely great. Okay, here's a chance to catch up, Brian, because we're going to move on to current affairs. I hope you've both been reading your newspapers, and I'm so glad I managed to rescue the currents.
The Sun.
Okay, here we go. A rabbit took an expensive trip this week. What was it called, and where did it travel? Any answers to that at all?
No.
It was called Honey Bunny. It was the Libyan ambassador's pet rabbit, and it was flown over here at a cost of £3,000. Does anybody in the audience know Which paper flew the rabbit over here?
Daily Mail.
The Mailie Dale.
Mailie Dale.
Do I get a sandwich?
No, I'm afraid you each get one piece of bread because it has a little bit of help from the audience there. Okay, which famous Spanish artist turned 80 this week?
Leonardo da Vinci.
I think he probably just turned in his grave. I don't know about turning 80. Any, yes, an answer.
The one with the big moustache.
Yes, what's his name? Taken Daly.
Daly.
Salvador Daly.
Salvador Daly.
Absolutely correct. Okay, so that's a current
Salvador Daly out of the day.
Mama doesn't like
it. Current sandwich.
Current
okay, Mama, you've
like
got to hurry up and catch up. Okay. Which British boxer is going to face a bone crusher at Wembley this weekend?
Bruno.
Frank Bruno. Absolutely.
Yeah.
You can get another sandwich if the audience can find me a photograph of Frank Bruno in five. One.
Back
page.
Two.
I got it.
Four. Absolutely correct. The picture there in the star, is it? I think it is.
Star.
That's another sandwich to you. Now, you've really got to move it, Mama, to get you.
I got a half one.
Okay. Which prince has had to pay up for his prank? That's a jolly difficult one to say.
Andrew.
It's Andrew.
Yes, I think it was in there first.
Yeah. It was
in there. Okay.
I was busy with me current.
A lot of school children had an extra holiday this week. Why? Yes.
Because the school teachers are stressing.
I think half a sandwich each on that. Sharing going on there.
But okay. I'm going to make a long political
quickly,
speech.
Quickly, no, I haven't got time for that now. You've got to make a sandwich and move on. Where did Ken Livingstone's mother, Mrs. Livingstone, that's nice, a bit of sharing, you see there was sharing going on over the carrots. Where did Ken Livingstone's mother meet the Queen this week? Yes. Don't know, quickly.
No, the Thames Barrier.
The Thames Barrier.
Turn it in quickly. Now, count your sandwiches and see who moves on to fast food. How many have you got there,
Mark? One, two, three.
Yes, Brian.
Four, five, six, seven, eight.
Eight sandwiches.
I got eight and one.
8-1. I think that makes Mama the winner. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mama. Oh, sorry about now. Here's your chance, Brian. Yeah. See if you can't stop him from winning the golden loaf.
Yeah.
Here is a jigsaw puzzle of the perfect sandwich.
Yeah.
I want you to put it together before Mama has time to answer three correct questions.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. I'm going to describe a kind of food to you, Mama, and you see if you can guess what it is, okay?
Mama knows
okay, it's a kind of reptile, and you eat them, the French eat them, they have long green things.
Snails.
And it's the, no, they're long and green, and the...
Oysters.
Ribbit.
Oh, frogs.
Frogs, absolutely right, frogs. Okay, still in France, you take your shoes off and you press them. And,
wine.
And you make them into wine. Grapes, absolutely correct. Okay,
shape.
You've got to get another one right. Okay, it's a long yellow fruit. It's got sort of stripes and a
banana.
A banana, absolutely. How have you done there, Brian?
It's not a whole.
Brilliantly made. Nothing at all. Well, I'm awfully sorry about that. I'm afraid you get our consolation
loaf there,
Brian.
Mama's going to cook you something,
and,
right?
Mama, I'm afraid I haven't got... Oh, yes, I have. It's right here. I don't know what I'm doing today. Here we have the golden loaf, carefully inscribed for you, this week's sandwich quiz winner.
Oh, my God. Santa Madonna, Marina, Maria, Santa Venda, 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 Santa Venda,